Hello, my name is Steve Brown, and I'm the worship leader at Vintage Faith Church. At Vintage Faith, we believe the Word of God is what changes and transforms a person. We hope you enjoy the next 30 to 40 minute sermon of the Word of God being proclaimed and explained. Enjoy the message.
Welcome, church. Is everyone ready to worship this morning? Worship and hear the word? In Psalms, it is written, "O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker." Let's do that together. Hey, Eddie, I'm not getting the click.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Could fathom such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me.
Silence, the roaring lion. gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ still which we stand. Oh, sing
you. We praise you this morning. We worship you. We thank you that you are our hope in life and death. We thank you that your grace and goodness is known in the blood of Christ that was poured out on the cross. We thank you for all of these things. This is our saving faith. This is why we're here. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Hello, good morning. We are springing ahead with our walk with Jesus. I had to do it. We're in week 10 of the book of John. Our scripture is Exodus chapter 3, 7 to 15. Then the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? He said, but I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come together this morning to consider, to worship, to hear from you. Lord, you are the creator of the universe. You spoke the world into existence. You are the great I am. But let us not forget your tenderness. Lord, many of us in here are weary and burdened. Comfort us, give us rest. Many of us are mourning. Pray for comfort for those. Lord, we come to you hungering and thirsting for righteousness. Pour your spirit down upon us. Lord, there's people in here that feel hopeless and need hope. Give us hope. Lord, some of us feel shame and guilt. Clothe us with glory and dignity. Lord, we're weak. We need your strength. Lord, we're sinners in need of a Savior. Lord, I pray that we can be a church that opens our doors wide to the hurting and the hungry. The hungry can come and they can eat without price, and the thirsty can come and drink without price. So, Lord, we as a church body, we humbly come to you this morning. We just ask that you pour your spirit down upon us. Comfort us where we need comfort. Encourage us where we need encouragement. Exhort us and challenge us where we need to be challenged. Lord, we are all sheep who have gone astray, and you are the great shepherd, Lord. And we acknowledge that as a people, as a church, that we need you. It's not by our righteousness, but by yours. We pray this in your name. So, as you know, we've been in the Gospel of John, and as we talked about early on in this book, John is really a master at going deep into the Old Testament. All these stories that we're hearing, they didn't just come out of nowhere. Jesus didn't just come out of nowhere. This has been a story building since the creation of the world, even before the creation of the world. One of the great joys in my Christian walk has been learning about and dwelling on just the bottomless riches of the gospel found in the storyline of the scripture. A statement such as Jesus died for my sins is certainly true and it's certainly right. But there's actually so much depth behind that. So much depth behind every word in that statement. And I desire for us as a body, as a church, that we can dig deep into the gospel. This is affection-stirring stuff, soul-stirring, worship-invoking stuff, this truth that we find in the whole storyline of Scripture. When we see Jesus span across time from Genesis all the way to Revelation, that's going to do something in your heart. It's going to awaken you. When you look out into the world and say, hey, what's going on this week or yesterday or what's going on this month? And when you see, no, we're part of a bigger story, a story so big that it started before the foundations of the world as we know it, to see the awesomeness and the unity of Scripture in the 66 books, 40-plus authors, over 1,000 years, and it all fits together. It's a beautiful thing. In the beginning of the Bible, we had paradise, Adam and Eve in paradise, and you know the story. Satan comes in, tempts, they question God's goodness, they eat, and they fall from paradise. And in the beginning of the Bible, we have a promise that just reverberates through every single book. If there's one verse in the Bible that has so much meaning that everything can kind of come out of, it's Genesis 3:15, when God says to the serpent, I'll put enmity, hostility, that means, between you and the woman, Eve, and between your offspring or seed and her offspring. He, the offspring of Eve, will bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. And so much comes out of this one scripture. The Bible follows this storyline from this scripture onward. We're going to look at that today. We're going to get to John, and when we're in John, we're going to show you how it's just right along this Genesis 15 line. So this promise is given, and then in Genesis, if you remember from our sermon series, there people are waiting for this offspring, right? Remember Lamech waiting when Noah was born? Hey, maybe Noah's the one. Maybe he's the one who's going to roll back the curse. Maybe he is the offspring of the woman. And then Abraham comes along, and he's given a promise, and then his son and his son. But if we go to Genesis 12, here's the promise, the same promise in Genesis 3:15, but it's just kind of opening up a bit. So the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation. And I will bless you, and I will make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and to him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you, in Abraham, in your offspring, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And this promise to Abraham, actually, Genesis 12, and just keep reading 13, 14, 15. It gets a little bigger, and you see this has to do with land. It has to do with offspring. It has to do with a nation. It has to do with kings. And it's just that Genesis 3:15, that offspring promise just getting bigger and bigger. And the Jews held to this. The Jewish people said, hey, we're offspring of Abraham. This promise to Abraham, that's us. We're the offspring. We're the ones that are blessed. We're the ones that if you curse, you're going to be cursed. And if you bless, you're going to be blessed. And they had great pride in the fact that they were children of Abraham. That was their heritage. A few chapters after this, turn to another book. God's people are in bondage. They haven't had the law yet. They haven't been to Mount Sinai yet. They're in bondage by the Egyptians. And we see here in Exodus 2, and God heard their groaning. And God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God saw the people of Israel, and God knew. So the people of God, they're in bondage in Egypt. God hears their groaning, and he remembers the covenant we just read with Abraham, that I'm going to make you a great nation, and the world is going to be blessed through you. So the story continues, and Moses ends up in the desert, ends up in Midian. He felt like he was the one to deliver God's people, but he kind of jumped a little ahead, a little too soon. He ends up in Egypt because Pharaoh wants to kill him, or he ends up out of Egypt in Midian, and he sees this burning bush, and God tells him to take off his sandals, and God tells him, I'm going to send you to Pharaoh, and you're going to tell him, free my people. And Moses, like any of us would do, gets nervous. Well, who am I? Who am I to say anything to Pharaoh? Moses says to God, Exodus 3, 13 to 15, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, God, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What is this God's name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever. And thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. This is my name. I am. I will be who I will be. I am who I am. God says to Moses, tell them, I am, has sent you. When you read your Bible and you see Lord in all caps, L-O-R-D, O-R-D, and in kind of a small version of caps, the word here is Yahweh. It's God's personal name. This is God saying, this is my name, Yahweh. I am who I am. And this is going to come into play in the scriptures that we look at today. Alec Moyder says, talking to Christians, without the Old Testament, we could not know the Lord Jesus properly. This idea has huge ramifications. First, it means that the Bible is not two testaments, but one book with one great subject. And since the subject is Jesus the Savior, it means that in this one book, there is one way of salvation. Therefore, one love which drew salvation's plan, one God, one people destined for salvation. The Old Testament is our book. It belongs to the people of Jesus and to no one else. The Old Testament is our book. It's our history. It's ours. We hold it. We read it. It's for us. Don't fall into the theology that says that was for Israel. That's not true. The Old Testament is our book, and we're going to see that today in the book of John. All right, let's begin our narrative. We have, again, like much of the book of John, Jesus arguing with the religious establishment. He's arguing with them. But this one starts off a little different. John 8, 31 to 37. And just kind of file this first verse away. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him. Okay? He said to the Jews who had believed in him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. They answered him, "We are offspring of Abraham." So there's that Abrahamic promise. "We've never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me because my word finds no place in you." So we've got to do something with this, and we're going to explore this. But first verse, the Jews who believed in him, last verse that we just read, "You seek to kill me because my word finds no place in you." He says to the Jews, if you abide in my word. So that's the idea. If you stay in it, if you continue in it, if you love it, if you seek it, you're truly my disciples. Don Carson says this about this particular verse. He says, a genuine believer remains in Jesus' teaching. Such a person seeks to understand it better, finds it more precious, more controlling, precisely when other forces flatly oppose it. So that's what we all need to be asking ourselves. Do we find the Word of God more precious, more controlling? Do we have a desire to hear what God says in His Word, even when the world around us says that we're crazy and everything around us says this is nuts? The world opposes God's word, and that's going to have some costs for us. But a genuine believer remains even when the world flatly opposes it. I think what we've seen so far in John is Jesus isn't interested in gathering large crowds. He seems to gather the large crowds and then he pares them down with his preaching. He actually keys up his preaching and presses them and gets us thinking, hey, count the cost. He goes on, he says, abide in my word. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So certainly in mind here is the idea that when we come to faith in Christ, we're set free. We're set free from sin, from bondage, from death, really. We're set free. But the other thing that I think is in mind here for the believer is when we live in line with God's word, we're going to live a life of freedom. Reality will mug us at some point. If you are living contrary to reality in any way, at some point you're going to be mugged by reality. You can live against God and His purposes, but at some point, reality just comes to collect. Anyone who's gone down roads of sin and really given themselves to it, you know this. You give yourself, and one day you wake up and you're paying for it. We can suppress the truth. We can kick against the goads. But this is ultimately slavery. Jesus calls this slavery. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He, Him, a person, and at the same time, He teaches us how to live in freedom. The narrative goes on. They say, we're offspring of Abraham. We are the blessed ones. We're not enslaved to anyone. Now think about this for a minute. Israel. The Jews have been enslaved to Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Greece, Syria, now Rome. They have been enslaved to every major superpower over the course of thousands of years. So truly, what Jesus has in mind, and I think what the Pharisees are hearing here, is slavery to sin. And they're saying, we've never been enslaved. We're righteous. We don't need to be set free. Our father is Abraham. I don't know what you do when you realize that you've hurt someone, when you realize that you've been sinning against someone, when you realize that maybe you haven't loved someone that you should be loving well. So maybe you didn't sin by commission, but omission. You didn't do something that you should have done. I don't know what you do when you have that conviction, if you have conviction. But I'll tell you what I do. First, I try to justify myself. And I try in every way to say why I was right. And I kick against that, kick against the goads. Well, you know, I did that because of this. And well, you were doing that. And so I did this. Of course I would have done this. Yeah, I'm kind of sorry, but you know. And eventually, as I do that, I start realizing how foolish I am. And at some point, I have a conviction. Yeah, it's me. It's me. I'm the problem in this situation. Have you ever thought in your life, man, this person is annoying me? And then you go hang out with another group of people and you're like, I don't know what's going on. They're annoying me too. And then you go home and they're annoying you too. And then you start to realize, man, there's really one common denominator in every situation, and it's me, right? But our tendency in our heart is to kick back and to justify and to say, well, it's not that big of a deal. It's not that big of a deal. But that's not why Jesus died. He died on the cross so we can bring that to him and he can cleanse us of our sin. That's freedom. The slavery is what the Pharisees are doing here, saying, we're not enslaved. I'm self-righteous, man. Thank God I'm not like other men. Thank God I'm not like them. I'm fasting multiple times. I'm in my Bible. I'm doing this. But if you remember that parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector, the tax collector came and he beats his breast and he says, I'm not worthy, God. I'm a sinner. And Jesus said, that man went home justified, not the Pharisee. Even if we think in the Bible, you think about this category, and I want you to think about it of when Jesus says, being set free. Sin, when you can think about sin and actually be honest enough in your own heart to say, yes, I've hurt people, yes, I'm a part of this, there's a freedom in that. Because your conscience is telling you anyway that you're grumpy, and as you try to justify it, there's still something in you that knows that you were wrong. This is why we see commands in the Bible that say, show hospitality without grumbling. Why is that in there? Because God knows that many times we will show hospitality and we'll be grumbling. Or bear with one another. Well, that sounds all nice and fine, but when you're living side by side with people or you're in a church and you're seeing people often, there's going to be people and there's going to be times where you have to obey this command and live in the truth, or you can act on every thought and every emotion. And that is slavery. I don't know if you've ever lived like that, but I know I've had periods in my life where I've said, if I'm angry, I'm going to vent. If I've got a problem with someone, I'm going to talk to them. That doesn't work well. sometimes you need to talk to that person, and sometimes your anger has to get out there in some way. But if you're just giving it all and acting on it all, you're living in slavery. You're going to be a slave to all of your choices. There was a point in my searching and in my walk. I had been really reading some of the Eastern mystics and Buddhist books and really digging in my early 20s. And when I started to read the Bible and I started to read about sin, I never felt so free in my life, because every other book or philosophy I was reading was completely denying that the human heart was sinful, and there was something in me saying, yeah, this is great, but my heart, what's wrong with me? When I started reading in the Bible about that category for sin, I felt free for the first time in my life. Like, oh, this isn't just me. Oh, God is actually reading my heart and telling me what's wrong with it and giving me the solution to it. G.K. Chesterton says this. He was an Englishman and long dead, but he says something similar. He's like, the modern philosophers were telling me that I was in the right place and that I was okay and that everything was fine, but when I was finally told that I wasn't and that something was wrong with me, my heart sang with joy. That's freedom. There's freedom in the gospel, and part of that gospel is that we're sinners and that we need a Savior. All right, the conversation is continuing. So remember where we were. Jesus says to the Jews who believed in him, but then at the end he says, my word finds no place in your heart. John 8, 38 to 42. I speak of what I have seen with my Father, and you do what you have heard from your father. They answered him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would be doing the works Abraham did. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. You are doing the works your father did. They said to him, we were not born of sexual immorality. We have one father, even God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me. For I came from God, and I am here. I came not of my own accord, but he sent me. So again, here the flow of this conversation. Jesus is kind of introducing a category to them that, hey, you've got a different father than God. You don't have the same father that I have. And speaking in terms of God, not human fathers. And they say, Abraham is our father. Again, we're children of Abraham. We're the children of the promise. But Jesus said, you seek to kill me. This isn't what Abraham would have done. You're doing the works that your father did. Jesus is the radiance of the glory of God. He's the exact imprint of his nature. In fact, in the beginning of John, remember, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus Christ is God. When he talks to the disciples, he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I and the Father are one, he says. Once had a friend who I used to work with, he asked me, we were talking about Jesus, talking about the gospel, and he just said, I don't understand. Why did God send Jesus? Why didn't he make himself known? It's so confusing. Why did he send Jesus and we have to wonder? And the answer to that is you don't have to wonder. When you see Jesus, you see God. When we read about Jesus in the Bible, we're reading the very words of God, and you either see it or you reject it. There's no middle ground, as we looked at last week and we're going to look at again. There's just not a middle ground. The only way to stay in the middle ground is to stay ignorant and to say, I don't want to hear it, I don't want to see it, I don't want to know what he said. But when you really dig into what Jesus said, you either have to call him a demon and call him possessed, or call him Lord and call him Savior. John 8:43, Jesus goes on, he says, why do you not understand what I say? It's because you cannot bear to hear my word. He knows it. They can't bear to hear it. They don't want to hear it. This means I don't want to hear your word. I don't want you, God. I don't want you, Jesus. Don't talk to me. I don't care what you say. They couldn't bear to hear it. And he knew this. They believed in Jesus. Our whole scripture today started with that. The Jews who believed in him, but they believed in him. They wanted something out of him that wasn't who Jesus was. They wanted a Messiah that was going to free them from Rome. They wanted a political Messiah. And Jesus is saying, I am much more than a political Messiah. My mission is much bigger than that moment in time in Palestine. And we can wrestle with God's word. So I want to give you a little comfort here. I think every true believer wrestles with God's word. There's things in his word that we read and our flesh doesn't want to hear. It doesn't want to hear it. And I don't know what that is for you. I know what it's been for me, and it continues to be. As I read the Bible and I read something and it's like that can't be true. Am I reading this wrong? But God didn't come into this world to help us achieve the desires that we already had and already have in our flesh. He came to give us completely new desires. The desires that we were made for, a desire to commune with God, which is not natural. So we have to recognize that we have a part of us in us, even Christians, that's wrestling and not wanting to be under certain scriptures. We want to be over the scripture. Are you wrestling with God? One of the good things is if you're wrestling with him, you're seeing him for who he really is. If you're not wrestling, maybe you're not seeing him for who he is. There's only two options. We either spit at him and call him a demon, or we fall on our knees and we worship him. The popular trend right now in the church in America is to take some of the scriptures that are difficult and to kind of just flatten them out. Well, I love Jesus just as long as he doesn't tell me what to do with my body. Or I love Jesus, but I want to be popular and liked, so if I get into a situation where that is the case, I'm just going to shut up and not say anything. Or I love Jesus, but my Jesus doesn't talk about sin or justice or wrath. But if you read the Bible honestly, you're not going to find this made-up Jesus. He's not in there. He's not. the Jesus that you're going to find is much stronger, much mightier, much more loving, and worthy of your worship and your heart. He's not a genie in a bottle. In the Chronicles of Narnia, there's this scene, and it, I know some of you in here probably haven't seen it, but I'm guessing there's a lot of you that have. There's a lion, Aslan. Aslan represents Christ, God, in the Chronicles of Narnia. And there's a young girl. Her name is Lucy. So you've got like this imaginary world, Narnia. You've got God, Aslan the lion. You've got evil kind of ruling. And this family, these kids end up in Narnia. And one of the kids, Lucy, she's hearing about Aslan, hearing about the lion. And they're saying, hey, Aslan's on the move. Something's happening. And she's talking to Mr. Beaver, a beaver that talks. And she says, is he safe? Talking about Aslan. Is he safe? And he says, safe? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's good. He's the king, I tell you. This is the Jesus that we worship. He is not safe. He's a roaring lion. He's king. He's Lord. And he will demand all of us. We can't come to him and just give him part. We can't just have part of him. It's all or nothing. And all of us are wrestling through that giving of ourselves. That's something that's going to be the rest of our walk. But I would just encourage you, keep wrestling, keep giving. He's good. He's not safe, but he's good. So the Pharisees say, if God was your father, you would love me. So the narrative goes on in John 8. So here he comes out with it, right? He's been kind of planting the seeds. You don't have the same father as me. And now he says, you are of your father, the devil. There it is. Your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. So get what Jesus is calling. Go back to Genesis 3:15. You've got this drama that's going to play out, and it plays out in the entire scriptures. The offspring of the woman, which is God's people, the offspring of the serpent, which are people against God's people, all those who rejected God. You've got these two offsprings, and it's playing out even now in the world. You've got the church being persecuted. God's people have always been persecuted. And Jesus calls the Pharisees offspring of the serpent. You think you're Abraham's offspring, but you're actually offspring of the serpent. Why? Because the serpent was trying to kill me, and now you're trying to kill me. You're doing the same thing. You're doing the same works that the devil did. In the book of Revelation, you've got this idea, and in Revelation 12, 3-5, this is the idea here of Satan wanting to take out Christ at his birth. So the devil has wanted to kill the Messiah since the Messiah was born and thought he had victory on the cross. And now he just wants to kill and persecute God's people. But Revelation 12, 3-5, and another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon. So now the serpent is a dragon, a great red dragon with 7 heads, 10 horns, and on his head 7 diadems. His tail swept down 1/3 of the stars of heaven and cast them to earth. So that's most likely 1/3 of the angels. Satan comes down, his fall. If you keep reading in Revelation, it's going to talk about the fall of the serpent from heaven. Sweeps down a third of the stars from heaven cast on the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman. So some say the woman is real, or it could be Mary, but there's a woman about to give birth. And the dragon, so imagine a dragon standing before this woman about to give birth, so that when she bore her child, he might devour it. She gave birth to a male child, one who is to rule all the nations. This is Jesus with a rod of iron, but her child was caught up to God and to his throne. And we see this in the Gospels. When Jesus is born, what does Herod do? Kill all the babies, 2 years old and younger. I want them all dead. I want this Messiah dead. So Satan working through Herod to kill the offspring of Eve, the offspring of Eve. And Revelation goes on in Revelation 12, 17. Then the dragon became furious with the woman and went off to make war on the rest of her offspring. That's us. On those who keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony of Jesus. And he stood on the sand of the sea. So this is this epic battle. And Jesus is calling it out in John. He's bringing us back to this battle, that there's a battle between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. Thomas Schreiner says this: Satan stands before the woman as she is about to give birth so that he can destroy the Christ. Nothing has changed, for the devil has been a murderer from the beginning. The seed of the serpent, Cain, put to death the seed of the woman, Abel. The devil tried to rid the world of Israel through Pharaoh. The devil incited Saul to try to kill the Lord's anointed, David. The devil worked through Haman when he tried to murder Mordecai and wipe out the Jewish people. The devil tried to put to death the Christ. And we see later in the story that the devil continues to persecute the church. We have a great and terrible enemy, and he hates us and hates our Christ. So when we hear this story in the gospel, there's a depth to it. There's a depth to this story. The Pharisees eventually put Jesus to death. And Jesus calls them out and said, you're doing the same things that your father, the devil, has done. All right, the narrative continues, John 8, 48 to 52. The Jews answered him, are we not right in saying that you're a Samaritan and have a demon? So there it is again, right? Every time Jesus begins pressing in, he eventually gets them to a point where they say, you're demon-possessed. You've got a demon. You can't say these things, Jesus. You cannot say these things. Jesus answered, I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it, and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. The Jews said to him, now we know you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets, yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. So think about it. The Pharisees, the Jews, they're like, we got him. He said it. He said that crazy thing again that he always comes to. He says it. He's got to die. Jesus says, whoever keeps my word will never taste death. If you know Jesus, you will pass from life to eternal life, and you will not taste death. These are hearkening back to John 3:16. Whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. So the narrative continues, and they say to him, are you greater than our father Abraham? So here we go, right? They're now trying to get him to even say more. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died, and the prophets died? Who do you make yourself out to be? So again, you're doing it again, Jesus. You're doing it again. You cannot say these things. You've gone too far. Just be the Jesus that I want you to be. Again, we're talking to Jews that had believed him, that they wanted something out of him. Jesus answered, if I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say, He is our God, but you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. And he goes on to say, your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So when you think about the whole storyline of Scripture, actually in the book of Galatians, Paul says that the gospel was preached to Abraham. So the gospel, the promise to Abraham and the promise in Genesis 3:15, it's all the gospel. The gospel is just deep and big, and it's from Genesis right through Revelation. Remember, Eve, is Abel going to be the one? Is he going to be the one to roll back the curse of death and toil? And Cain, the seed of the serpent, kills Abel. Then it's Seth, maybe Seth, Lamech, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, David. The gospel was preached to Abraham. And Jesus said, he saw it. He saw my day. He was glad. He looked forward to it. So the Jews said to him, you're not 50 years old and you have seen Abraham? And here, think back to Exodus. Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. He drops a bomb on him. Before Abraham was, I am Yahweh. There's no misunderstanding after Jesus said this of who he is claiming to be. I am the one true God of Israel, he is saying. I am the covenant-keeping God who led you out of Egypt, out of bondage, parted the Red Sea, gave you manna from heaven, led you by smoke and fire. I led Joshua into the promised land. I am Yahweh. And what do? They pick up stones to throw at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out to the temple. I hope you can see the pattern in the Gospel of John. It's been in a number of sermons. And as I was studying and trying to figure out where to go next, I'm like, I can't get away from this. Jesus is arguing at every point. He's pushing them at every point. Like, part of me is like, can't you just give me, God, a nice fluffy sermon where I don't have to go and press and challenge? But it's not, I'm telling you, in the book of John, it is not there. And we give this book to people who are searching, and rightly so, but this is a book where Jesus is pressing and saying, do you believe me for who I am, or do you believe me because you want something? And we all have to ask ourselves that question. What are our true intentions? Jesus demands all of us. Can't have him any other way. We can't come to him any other way. We can't have Jesus and yet still be over him and not submitting ultimately to something that he is calling us to submit to. We can't use him. But by giving all of us, all of ourselves, we're not losing anything. We're gaining everything. So if you're wrestling in here with that, you may be feeling like, hey, if I give my life to Christ, I'm going to lose. I'm going to lose whatever it is. But you won't. Jesus says when you give your life, you lose your life. You will find your life. You'll find it in a way that you've never known was even possible. Maybe it's time to give up and say, nevertheless, your will, God, not mine. Is your Jesus the great I am? I pray that he is. This is a Jesus that can be worshipped. This is a Jesus that's going to stir your heart, that's going to change your life. He's worthy to be worshipped. Any of that made-up Jesus that we see out in our culture, he's not a Jesus worthy to be worshipped. Jesus is worthy to be worshipped. We've been singing a song that we're going to sing here in a minute called Is He Worthy? We've been singing it for a few months, and it's from the book of Revelation, which was also written by John, the same John that we're studying. And I just want to read a bit before we sing from Revelation 5, 1-5. So again, this is the same John that we've been studying. Then I saw on the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." This is a picture of authority. He is the only one with authority. Jesus Christ is the only one worthy, the only sacrifice that was worthy to die as a substitute for your sin and my sin, the only king worthy, and the only worthy object of worship. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we, as we worship in this last song and sing about how you are worthy, I pray that you stir in the hearts of the people here just a desire to know you and worship you and be under you instead of fighting you, and to give up that fight and to let you be Lord of our life, King of our life, Savior. Lord, stir in our hearts a love for you. Lord, we love you, and we pray this all in your name. Amen.
Through and the Lamb who died to
Lord, keep watch between you and me when we are away from each other. Be filled with the Spirit this week. You're dismissed, church.
Thank you for listening to the Vintage Faith Podcast. At Vintage Faith, our vision is to help people who are far from God to become totally devoted followers of Jesus. We pray that this podcast brought you closer to God. For more information, check us out at vintagefaithcicero.com.